Now, stimuli can vary in their qualities, intensity, duration, frequency, physical resemblance to one another. So I got a bell ringing, bing, feed the dog, bing, feed the dog, right? Well, that bell is a stimulus. It has an auditory sound to it. I could do the same thing with a light. I could flash a light of a certain hue. Now, dogs seeing in black and white still detect shades of difference, right? And so I could flash a light of a certain hue, and that hue only predicts food. All the other hues don't predict food. So I do it, food, do it, food, and then I can turn on the light of that hue, and I'll get salivation just as if I was ringing the bell and doing it. That's what Pavlov found out. It didn't really matter what the stimulus was that was previously neutral. Anything would do it. So let's say I'm going at a wavelength of 550 nanometers. I don't know where that is on the spectrum. Anybody know? I don't know. Y'all know Roy G. Biv, right? Red, orange, yellow, green. Let's just say it's a pure green for the sake of argument. It's in the middle of the spectrum, right? Ultra red that way, ultraviolet that way. So I got this pure 550 nanometer controlled stimulus. Flash it, give the food. Flash it, give the food. Now, I flash it, I get salivation. But let's say I go slightly this way. So I'm now flashing a light that's a little more yellow than the pure tone. Not the tone that had been, or not the hue that had been associated, right, with the food, but it's kind of like the hue that was associated with the food, and I get a partial response. That's stimulus generalization. I'm getting a response to a stimulus that's not the conditioned stimulus, but is close enough to it, right? So in terms of my friend, I might have hung out with somebody that looked like my friend. Wouldn't be the conditioned stimulus, but he might have looked enough like my friend to create that sense of craving. To the degree that you get no response, it's discriminated, which is the opposite of how most people think about discrimination. When most people think about discrimination socially, as we'll see in the social chapter, they're talking about treating every single person as if they fit one label that's often erroneous, right? What are they doing? They're taking that label and they're generalizing it to everybody who fits that label. But in this case, discrimination is actually distinguishing from, in other words, making fine distinctions, not generalizing, right? So I now go out here into a red hue and I get no salivation. That's stimulus discrimination. I go way out here and I get a violet and I get no salivation. That's stimulus discrimination. And I find it easier to make it look like that because that's a little bit academic in the other way. You ever been bit by a dog? I've been bit by a dog. I don't hate all dogs, right? But I did have a strong aversion to the dog who bit me after it bit me. Because the next time I went near that previously neutral stimulus that applied the unconditioned stimulus of pain, right, I then had an adrenaline response, which made me feel uncomfortable. That's a physiological thing, and this is where I say it applies to operant and classical conditioning. This is classical conditioning. That sense of foreboding you have is cognitive, but that feeling of your butterflies in your stomach or your heart fluttering or your heart rate changing or your breath changing or tremoring in your hands or clamminess, those things are physiologically conditioned in a classical sense. So that sense of that nervousness that was physical was classically conditioned to the dog that bit me. Right? You see? Previously neutral. But what if I started feeling that way to a dog that was kind of like that dog? Maybe another German Shepherd, but not the same one. Then that would be stimulus generalization causing that feeling that I was having physiologically. If I went the other way, I still got a large dog, and it has a similarity to the stimulus, right? So it's causing a response. But if I get far enough away from it, in terms of size or appearance or whatever, now I'm not having the same physiological response. Doesn't mean I couldn't eventually acquire that, but now it's stimulus generalization, or excuse me, discrimination. Out here where I have no response with kitty, right? Kitty's not similar enough to the dog to cause it, it's stimulus discrimination. Now, the operant side of the house says, if I feel this uncomfortable feeling that comes with the fight or flight response, I leave. And as we'll see, leaving is a voluntary behavior, right? Avoiding the situation is a voluntary behavior. It could become that I now start avoiding all dogs that resemble this because it causes me this aversive feeling. And so now I'm going to be more likely to avoid them because leaving is negatively reinforced because it removes the aversive feeling. So I'm more likely to leave or avoid the situation. We'll talk more about that. Everybody get the concept of stimulus, generalization, and discrimination? With our conditioned stimulus, we're going to get the response. With things that are close enough to the individual organism that resemble it enough, whether it's a bell or a tone or a hue or a sign or a physical creature or object, I'll get some response, but not as strong a response as the original conditioned stimulus. The further away I get from that conditioned stimulus in terms of resemblance, the less likely I am to get the response. Now, this is important for survival. When you talk about the functionalist, William James, we go back to that. What does that do for us? Well, pain, fear, and sickness, as I said before, you can establish these aversions in one trial. To get a dog to slobber to a bell, or to get you to slobber to a bell, which we could do just as easily with the exact same procedure, right? We would have to do it over and over and over and over again to establish it. Multiple trials through the acquisition phase. But pain, fear, and sickness only require one trial. Touch the stove how many times? One time, and you learn it, right? Get assaulted on a corner at gunpoint. How many times do you have to have that happen before you now have that aversion to that corner? One time. Stick your finger in the light socket. One time. Put 9-volt battery on your braces. I did that one time. That was all it took. It was well established. Now, you may have had a food that you ate when you were younger that you can't stand to eat or smell now. Anybody got that condition? That's normal. That's normal. It can last a lifetime because of this classical conditioning and the operant conditioning combined, Maurer's two-factor theory. What happened? You ate something, you got sick, then smelling or seeing that food again gave you that feeling, right? You ever drink too much? Not y'all, of course. Some people drink too much, right? I drink too much Jack Daniels, for example, and they puke everywhere. They get really, really sick. And then the next time they see or smell that brown liquor, they go, Not voluntary, right? It's an involuntary reaction. It's a physical quiver, right? Maybe it was shrimp that made you sick. And the next time you saw the shrimp and smelled the shrimp, you went, I don't want that. But you don't think about it. It just happens. That's a classically conditioned reaction. That does what functionally? Makes you avoid things that might kill you. If you can imagine being in the wild and coming up on some berries, being very hungry, you ate them, but they were poisonous and you didn't know that. If you survived, the last thing you'd ever want to do is eat those berries again, and your body is prepared to help you do that. Now, what's interesting and different between poison berries and shrimp that make you sick or the brown liquor that makes you sick is that in the latter two cases, it's not actually the shrimp that made you sick. It was bacteria that made you sick, right? It wasn't the brown liquor. It was the alcohol inside of it. So now let's look at stimulus, generalization, and discrimination. So somebody who gets sick on seafood may say, oh, I don't like any seafood. Right? To the degree that more types of seafood give them the same feeling, that's stimulus generalization, right? So another person might go, I can't drink Jack Daniels anymore. It makes me feel queasy. And I can't drink wild turkey either because it's so similar to the other one. But it wasn't the brown liquor because then they can go and drink a beer, right? Why can they do that? Because the unconditioned stimulus wasn't the brown liquor. It was the alcohol in the liquor. Now the alcohol is in the beer, but the beer is so dissimilar in smell and taste from the original conditioned stimulus of brown liquor that they can now ingest it without any problem. Same thing with the shrimp, right? So maybe the shrimp did it, but if you can eat clams or you can eat something else that doesn't make you sick, you may not feel that way. Now the key is this, you can undo this. You can extinguish this yourself. It's how you get rid of phobias. And it's also how you get rid of conditioned taste aversions. Most people don't because they just avoid the food. Why do they avoid the food?
Make them sick.
Make them sick. It feels weird to smell it. But if they make themselves smell it, if they make themselves eat it, and it's properly cooked, or they don't take too much of it, in the case of the liquor, right, and they don't get sick again, then guess what happens? You get an extinction of that reaction. So my son, I think he was 5 at the time, maybe 4, used to like to go get vanilla ice cream with sprinkles at this place that was in Blacksburg where we lived at the time. And if he offered to go do that, he'd be happy to do it any day. We'd go on occasion when I had a little extra money in my pocket. So what an everyday thing. One day I say, you want to go get some vanilla ice cream with sprinkles? He's like, absolutely. And we go. He eats it, but he feels a little weird at that point. Later, we're going to go to the high school football game because his older sister is the lead snare in the band, and we always go up to watch the game. He likes sports, and she's playing, so we go to the game. It's like literally 2 blocks from our house, and he's looking a little peaked. I'm like, are you okay, man? He's like, yeah. You want to go? Yeah. We go, because if you're a dad, that's kind of what happens. I say, you okay? You say, you okay? We going. All right, we went, and we're walking across the parking lot. All of a sudden, he projectile vomits. Blah! Like Godzilla. It looked like this big beam of stuff coming out because I was happened to be looking down. And it all goes out in the parking lot. It's this white milky mixture with all these little colors swirled in it. It's vanilla ice cream with sprinkles in a new form. Right? And I'm like, damn, you're sick. And you know how it is after you throw up, sometimes you feel better. I'm like, do you want to go home? He's like, no, I'm okay now. So I'm a dad. We go see the game, and I don't think anything else about it. Later, I take his temperature. He's got a fever. He's got an illness, right? I don't think anything about it. But a few weeks go by. I'm like, you want to go get some vanilla ice cream with sprinkles? He's like, no, that's okay. Now, this is at least a couple hours after he's eaten the food. So it seems like for conditioned taste aversions, you have this long period where usually, like, you got to ring the bell, give the food, ring the bell, give the food. For food, it sometimes takes hours to become sick after you've taken in some kind of a virus or a bacteria. And so here it was, a totally unrelated event that I recognized after the second time. He said no the first time. The second time, I'm like, you want to go get some ice cream? He's like, nah, it's okay. He's not cognitive at 5 or 4 years old. He just doesn't want to go, right? So if I realize this, and I do, I'm like, oh, conditioned taste aversion. So what do? I bribe him to eat vanilla ice cream with sprinkles. I convince him to do it. I put some pressure on it, and he eats it, and he what? Doesn't get sick. Therefore, the power of that stimulus to cause the aversion is gone, and now he eats ice cream fine. However, had I not done that, it would have been very easy for him to go a lifetime not wanting vanilla ice cream anymore, and at the age that he got as an adult, he might never know why that was, because what happened was so early in his life that he may not remember the occurrence, and he probably doesn't remember the occurrence. I remember it because it fit perfectly with what I was teaching. I said, I can use that. That's a good example, very real world. A non-real world example was coyote attacks. So coyotes kill sheep, ranchers don't like coyotes killing sheep, so ranchers kill coyotes, and people who like coyotes get upset about that, and they say, well, can't you think of something else to do besides kill them? And they say, well, they're eating the sheep. Well, maybe you could think of something else. So Garcia, the first Hispanic to earn a PhD in psychology, and other colleagues had this idea, and they tested it out. It was amazing. I saw a film where I might not have believed it. You'll just have to believe me, because I don't have the film. It's very rare. They took captured wild coyote, kept it in a pen, didn't feed it. Coyote's hungry, right? They now put it into another pen, and they give it sheep mutton. It's got the hide and the little bits of fat and flesh on the hide. And the coyote does what coyotes do when they're hungry, eats it up. Unbeknownst to the coyote, it's laced with lithium chloride tablets, right? Coyote eats it, and about 20, 30 minutes later, is going, bleh, doing that projectile vomiting, right? You know how dogs do that. All right, ugh. So it's puking its guts out, which was by design. Coyote doesn't know what's going on. They didn't take coyote back to the original pen where they were holding him. They don't feed him. Coyote stays hungry. Next day, they bring coyote in to this other pen, and there's a live sheep there. And the coyote is hungry, and you think, this is going to be bad. Sheep are not really good at defending themselves, so it does what all of them do. Prepares to die. And the coyote comes at it to go for that throat, and gets right up into that wool, that hide, smells the sheep that was right previously not only neutral, actually pleasurable because it was what you ate to live, and goes, ugh. You can see the coyote like shiver and then back up and appraise the situation. And then it goes back because it's hungry and it tries it again, and this time moves even further back. The sheep just stands there like this, prepared to die, and eventually, probably just by accident, moves forward a little bit, and the coyote moves backwards. And the sheep moves forward, and the coyote moves backwards, and pretty soon the sheep is running the coyote around the pen. Coyote's terrified of the sheep because of what? Conditioned taste aversion. Right? Now, that shows you the difference between lab and reality, right? In a lab, it shows a really powerful effect. How are you going to do that in reality? And they put the hide of sheep up on poles laced with, but there's too many coyotes, and eventually they're going to get hungry enough that they're going to do what? They're going to persevere through that reversion. They're going to kill it. They're not going to get sick, and they'll extinguish that conditioned reaction. So, powerful. And another implication is in cancer treatment. Today we do much better than we used to. Back when I was in school, I was in 1996, I watched a video on chemotherapy where I saw a physician liken chemotherapy to throwing a hand grenade in the body and hoping you kill more bad cells than good. So people get really, really, really sick on it, right? It makes them not want to eat. It makes them not want to do anything. And so back in the old days, they would often tell patients, look, honey, you're not going to want to eat much of anything after you get this treatment. So what I'd do is I'd go out and treat yourself before you come into treatment, right? Go out and have a really big meal, something you really love, and enjoy it because you're not going to feel like eating for a week. And guess what they did by accident? Conditioned people to hate their favorite foods. And that conditioning is also tied into things like hospital settings and dentists. Dentists cause pain. Dentist was previously neutral. Eventually, people want to avoid the dentist because it becomes a stimulus associated with pain. And these phobias, conditioned responses, and aversions can last a lifetime after being learned in only one trial. However, extinction can occur.